It's Sunday night, and our subject is the doctrine of the devil. The doctrine of the devil is false doctrine. That's what it is. You either preach about, there's two doctrines, crucify the flesh, fulfill the flesh. That's it. We're not talking about whether you eat dinner or not, or whether you're hungry and you come and say, dear, I'm hungry, what's there for dinner? And she says, aha, you're practicing the doctrine of the devil. You want to fulfill your stomach. No. When you preach the doctrine of the devil, it is an excessive desire for self. When you want more than you possibly need, especially when the world is out here, our brothers and sisters are starving and they're hungry, and all you're wanting is another brand new car every year. And I know people that buy a new car every year. And I know women here in town, in Hendersonville, I was in real estate here for years, and they changed their furniture like I changed my socks. I mean, just literally, they would get rid of their furniture after having it a year in the den, get some more, and the next year, get rid of it, put it out in a garage sale, and just get rid of it. And this is a money town. Hendersonville is a lake town. This is where a lot of the stars, and I use that term loosely, I don't like stars, live. They buy these big super lake homes, $2 and $3 million on the lake, some of them a lot more than that. And I know what they're about. And I've seen people, I've seen also people in this town buy a house they could not possibly afford, and they're stretching themselves to the hilt paying $1,800, $2,000 a month house note. This is back in the early 80s. You go in their house to show their house, and they say, I haven't been able to buy furniture for my living room yet. It's coming in. I've ordered it. Well, their living room's been empty for 4 years. What they mean is I'm strapped to the hills with my house note, and I cannot possibly buy furniture for it. And there's people that actually live that way. And these people, if you buy a house that way, you're practicing the doctrine of the devil, because you're going after that which you cannot afford, and your epithumia, lust, like we said this morning, lust, the common word is epithumia, T-H-U-M-I-A, it means to breathe hard after, or superimpose breathing hard, saying, I got to have that house, whether I can afford furniture for it or not. And I know I'm an old pro, an old dog, and I know when something is happening, especially if I showed their house the year before and they didn't sell it back then, and then it was empty back then and it's empty this year. And then they say, I've ordered my furniture and it hadn't come in yet. What they've done is strapped themselves to the hilt. I know a fist through the drywall when I see it. They'll say, something happened here. The guy lost his temper and punched the drywall. I recognize that. I have done that when I was young. I'm embarrassed. Has anybody done that? Huh? I second that. And they'll make all kinds of excuses and say, that was where I bumped that with a piece of chair. No, that's got a fist shape in it. There's knuckles there. Don't be so naive to think that everybody else hadn't done these things. They have, haven't they? When you're young, you do crazy stuff. Now, the doctrine of the devil, when people are going after things they can't afford, the doctrine of the devil is the doctrine of distributing fortunes. That's what the Bible says, that in the latter times, there in 1 Timothy 4:1, the latter times some shall depart from faith. When you depart from faith, you go to the doctrine of the devil. Faith is everything that faith is. If you want to know what the doctrine of the devil is, you just define faith. That's all you do. Depart from faith. Depart from faith. And of course, depart is the word apistemi, H-I-S-T-E-M-I. And apistemi comes from apo, a removal of histemi. Histemi is a derivative. It doesn't look like it. There are no H's in the Greek. There's the diacritical mark. It's a breathing sound. So it's histemi with the H in front of it, histemi. And it's a derivative of the word stao, which means stake. And stasis means to be upright, something that's upright. The stake was upright, and it had the foundation, and it was standing upright. And a person who was said to be standing upright, another derivative of this is the word staros, and that is the word cross. And men have removed the daily cross from their life. They've actually moved the cross of Christ from their life Because the cross of Christ, as I've said here recently, the cross of Christ was an exclusive cross. It was only for the elect. Well, if you remove election and predestination, you remove Christ's cross, because he died only for his wife, the church, and gave himself for her. So if men don't believe in an exclusive cross, in other words, that Jesus only died for his wife, that his atonement was limited to his wife, nobody else. His wife is the church. If his atonement wasn't limited to his wife, and you talk about the cross of Christ, it's not the cross of Christ, it's only the cross of Christ whenever you believe in predestination and election. If you don't believe that, and you believe Christ's cross was for everybody in the world, that's a false cross. It is another. It's along with another Jesus in 2 Corinthians 11 and 4. Paul said, some will come preaching, and let me add one thing to this. Some will come preaching another Jesus, another spirit, another gospel, and another cross. I put the other cross in because the other Jesus is a Jesus that dies for everybody. And he goes on to say that the other Jesus is Satan transforming himself into an angel of light. Transformed, metaschematizo, S-C-H-E-M-A-T-I-Z-O, means to disguise oneself. Satan comes disguised as Jesus. I keep saying this. Satan is not going to deceive by dressing up in a red spandex suit with horns and a tail and hooves on his feet. That deceives nobody. How in the world, and all these preachers think this is evil, this Satanism, this people who, they draw these pentagrams and they draw a big cross and they sit in the middle of a room and they sit in the middle of this and they put a candle on each corner of this and they put a candle out here on this and on each corner, and then they sit in the middle and they kill a goat or kill a chicken and sprinkle the blood all over this floor out here, and they sit here and hum some mantra. Now, what is that going to deceive? That's not going to deceive anybody, is it? No possible way. The only thing that will deceive is a Jesus that's not the real Jesus. That's the only thing that's going to deceive a man. The only thing that will deceive somebody is a Jesus that preaches the wrong message. That's another Jesus, another cross, another spirit, another gospel. So if men depart from faith, they depart from believing in the real Jesus, don't they? If you don't believe in the real Jesus, you have to believe, and you say you believe in Jesus, and you go to a Baptist church, you go to a Methodist church, you go to a Church of Christ, and you don't believe the things, you cannot believe Jesus by carrying a Bible and say, I believe what's in it. Most people that carry a Bible to church don't know what's in it. If you start quoting Romans 8:29, say, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate, they will say, but it doesn't mean that. It means something else. Well, what they're doing, they're contradicting Christ, aren't they? They're contradicting Christ. The Bible says, and I've had people come here, we have people come here all the time and say, you know, I used to read those verses in Romans 9 and Romans 8, talking about God loving Jacob and hating Esau. And perhaps some of you were here, and they'd read it, and you'd go, I don't know what that means, because my preacher says that everybody has a chance and a choice, but this is Jacob, have I loved Esau, have I hated before they were born, before they had done any good or evil. But since I have been so indoctrinated by my preacher and by my mother and daddy and by my brothers and sisters and by their preacher and my grandfather, I guess it doesn't mean that, but I can't figure out what it means. It looks like it means that. But since I don't know much, they must be right. Has anybody had that experience? That's what I did with my father. I thought, well, daddy must know because I don't know. How would I know? I'm just a kid. And I would question everything he said when I was a kid, and I thought, this doesn't make any sense. We were talking about that at lunch with Martha. But all of us, didn't we all question it? Some of you were Roman Catholics. Weren't you questioning that when you had a Catholic church? All the elect question. They're looking for something because they've got it written in their hearts, and they're all looking for something. Well, whenever you contradict the Word of God, that makes you Antichrist. That's what the Bible says. Antichrist, the man who denies Christ, 1 John 2:22. If you deny Christ, you are Antichrist. And denies the word A-R-N-E-O-M-A-I. It means to contradict. If you contradict the word of God and say, well, it's true, but it doesn't mean what it says, then you are anti-Christ. Antichrist is only mentioned in 1st and 2nd John. It's not mentioned anywhere else in the Bible. It's not in Revelation. It's not in Daniel. But John said, even now are there many antichrists. Well, if you're antichrist, the word anti means in opposition to, in opposition to, or it means instead of. So if you are antichrist, you have placed yourself instead of Christ, instead of the Word of God, and you're saying Jesus doesn't mean what he says. That's what you're saying. He means exactly what he says. If he says in the world you shall have tribulation, he means every believer must go through tribulation. We were talking at dinner about how at the picnic, we were talking about all the different people and all the different testimonies and all the things they've gone through. The amount of problems this church has had, God's people are the sinners that he crushes out here. If Jesus came to the brokenhearted, to the bruised, to the crushed, in Luke 4:18, if he came to the crushed, that means you have to be crushed. That means you've got to have problems coming out your ears somewhere along the way. You look at some people and they look like real gentle and real quiet. Well, they look like they hadn't had any problems. Believe me, everybody here has had a lot of problems. You just because you look at them, they look sweet and angelic, it doesn't mean that that's what their life's been like. It means maybe they've gotten to a place where God has caused them to settle in and accept everything the way it is, but most people here have had some real, real hard, hard times. And sometimes people will draw away and say, well, I just don't want to be around people because they are better than me. No, you hadn't talked to them. If you get around to the people and start talking to them, you won't believe the problems other people have had or that are having. And when you really stop and look at their lives, when you do that, then you don't feel so alone. That's why I try to get people together and say, look, we're not talk about your sin to each other, but talk about the problems you've had and the things you feel and the things you think. You can't realize just how strong it makes you when you realize other people have the same problems you have or something that's along the same line. It can be physical or it can be health problems. It can be financial problems. It can be any number of other things. You can say, well, they have a lot of money. That doesn't mean anything. They may have everything. They may make a good living, but they may have every kind of health problem you can think of. We have to learn that God has got a system of calling his people. It's called crushing. He's got to crush self out of every... When he says, blessed are the poor in spirit, theirs is the kingdom of God. Or he said, I came to preach the gospel to the poor, to the brokenhearted. That word poor in both cases is that word P-T-O-C-H-O-S. It has the idea of a beggar standing in the shadows with his hand out saying, whatever you'd have me to have. That is the crushed people. I've said this, and I really mean this. Usually God's people are not middle-class white Americans. They're just not. There'll be a few, not many mighty, not many wise, not many noble in this world are called. There in 1 Corinthians 1:26. Not many, it doesn't say not any, but not many of those people are called of God. The people that are called of God are usually the people that are the downtrodden. It'll be the minorities. It'll be the crushed. It'll be, even if it's Caucasian people, it's going to be crushed people. It's going to be somebody that's been right down to the pit. I've said it right at death's door a couple of times. I mean right on death, right on eternity. If God will take you there, you'll realize some things. Get you right at death. When God is dealing with his people, he's causing us to believe the truth. The doctrine of the devil is departing from everything that faith is. Some shall depart, apistome, they'll leave the cross behind, they'll leave standing upright, they'll leave righteousness, they'll leave godliness, they'll leave holiness. And when I use the words holy, godly, righteous, I don't mean some Pentecostal thinking on it or some Nazarene thinking. The Nazarenes believe they live above sin. You know that, don't you? They say, we do not sin. I knew a Nazarene lady down here in Madison, and She said, when we make a mistake, what? When we make a mistake, what do you mean mistake? Well, you know, we do one of those things that you call sin. Make a mistake. No, it's not a mistake, it's sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves in 1 John 1:8. It amazes me, John is the one that said, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. He's the same one that said in the third chapter of that same book, 1 John 3:9, whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin. He says you can't live without sin. He says you can't live with sin. That's really kind of stand sideways until you realize what Paul said. If you'll notice, John correlates with Paul. 1 John 1:8, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. 1 John 3:9, whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin. The believer does not commit sin. And the believer commits sin. Well, if you don't know how to reconcile that, what are you going to do? Well, Paul says in Romans, the 7th chapter, the things that I would do, I do not. The things that I would not do, I find myself doing. So then it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. And then he goes at the end of that chapter and says, I've got an inner man that serves the law of God and an outer man that serves the law of the flesh. Oh, that's where it is, isn't it? He matches up with what John says. He says the outer man serves self and the inner man is death to self. And there's the two opposing doctrines. Self is the doctrine of the devil, and devil is daimonion, daimonion. And it comes from the root daio, and it means to distribute fortunes. Now, that's what these preachers are preaching in the world. They're distributing fortunes to themselves. They promise you fortunes, and they distribute to themselves. You know, I've got stacks of notes up here. I never get to my notes, hardly ever. There's just so much. And I've got all these notes on false prophets just all through the Bible. The Bible speaking about prophets that prophesy in my name, they prophesy false in Jeremiah 5:31, Jeremiah 11:21, Jeremiah 14:14, twice, Jeremiah 14:15, Jeremiah 14:16, Jeremiah 19:14, 23 and 16, Jeremiah 23 and 25, he talks all through here in the 23rd chapter of Jeremiah. He said, they prophesy in my name saying, the Lord saith. And he said, I didn't say it. I'm not talking to these people. I sent them not. I've got hundreds of verses on false prophets and false teachers, and I never hear any of these preachers talk about false prophets and false teachers. Never. That's why they think I am too angry when they hear me preach. They say, this guy's angry. Well, certainly I am. Go. The guys who say I'm angry are the lying false prophets, right? They're the ones that think I'm lying. They're the false prophets, the false teachers, and they say, or they think I'm too angry because they're liars. And never does the elect that come along and start getting a hold of these truths think I'm being too hard. We were sitting with Martha today down at the restaurant, and she said, well, I got angry before I found out that I was supposed to be angry. She said, I was angry a long time ago at these preachers, and I didn't know I was supposed to be angry. Well, Ephesians 4:26 says, be angry. And it's an imperative command. It's as much of a command as when Jesus said, let there be light. Or when he would say, Lazarus, come forth. It was that much of a command. Be angry. Or Orgizomai, O-R-G-I-Z-O. I mean, don't defend me by saying Jim's not angry. He said, well, certainly he's angry. He's angry at people that's stealing from the poor. You mean you're not angry at Kenneth Copeland? You did see my T-shirt. Kenneth Copeland's Jesus. Got the dollar signs there? That's who he is. The man is one of the lyingest low-life people in the world. So is T.D. Jakes. So is Creflo Dollar. Creflo Dollar is a child beater. Beat his kid, strangled her, and then he came on the internet and said, I've never hurt anyone with these hands. Never hurt. Then he's thinking, except when I choked my daughter and beat her because she wanted to go to a party. Am I surprised that he would choke his daughter and beat her? No. I had a guy that used to come here, and he played guitar for out there at Kenneth Hagin's Pagan Institute in Oklahoma, who was, and out there in Tulsa, and Hagin was the head of the word of faith movement, the positive confession. He said a friend of his was going bike riding with Kenneth Copeland and Jerry Savelle, and one of them went down on the bike, and they got down in the ditch, and they started cussing the bike when they was getting up. Am I surprised that Kenneth Copeland would cuss? No. Am I surprised that Richard Robert got arrested recently in Tulsa, Oklahoma for drunk driving? No. I'm not surprised at false teachers getting arrested for anything. I'm not surprised if one of them gets arrested for beating his wife or beating his daughter like Creflo Dollar. These guys have got to come out eventually. They don't have any truth. They have nothing to keep them from doing this sin. They don't have anything to keep them from cussing. Had one fellow come here, he said, Jan Crouch keeps a bar up there at TBN so people can drink if they want to. Had another fellow said, he went to New York with some of these people and they were up there drinking, going from club to club. Am I surprised at that? No. Am I supposed to be angry at that? Yes. Preaching in the name of Jesus and you live that way? I've been angry at these people all my life because I thought, this is hypocrisy. Well, Jesus wasn't that way. He loved everybody. He did not. You mean in John the 8th chapter when he said to the Pharisees, he said, your father's the devil, he's a liar and a murderer, and so are you? You mean that's loving them? And he called them children of hell in the 23rd chapter of Matthew. He said, your generation of snakes, your vipers. He said, your whited sepulchres, you're outwardly, you're clean, but in, you're full of extortion and dead men's bones inside. Is that sound like he liked them? He hated and despised the Pharisees. Jesus didn't like everybody. What do people come up with this? They don't read their Bibles, and if they do, they don't pay any attention to it while they're reading it. The doctrine of the devil is letting men have what they want and trying to get along with the world and just putting approval on every little nice thing that comes along and saying, I'm a Christian, I'm nice to everybody. Christians are not nice. They're kind. Remember, the word nice is the word niscere. It's a French word, N-I-S-C-E-R-E. I got a track over here I wrote, being kind is not nice. Kind. It is the word C-H-R-E-S-T-O-S. In the scripture, and it comes to the word kriya, and kriya is the word anoint, and we're anointed with truth, we're anointed with the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit's truth according to 1 John 2:27. We're anointed with truth, or the Holy Spirit, so when you're kind, you give people what they need spiritually. Nice is the word niskir, it comes from nay, oops. I started to put the second word, thinking ahead of time. Nay and skir. Skir is that word science. Science. Nay, it means no. It means no science or no knowledge. When you're nice, it's okay to be nice if you're really nice. Nice means you don't have any knowledge about anything. It's not okay to stay without knowledge. The only people that really are nice and it's okay with God are people who've got maybe Down syndrome, something like that. It's not okay to be nice. Nice means you have no knowledge. But people who look nice, they're not nice. They're acting nice. When you act nice, you're playing dumb. You're acting like you don't know what's going on. Do I believe that Billy Graham is as stupid as he acts? People think, most people in the world think Billy Graham is as nice and as no knowledge as he looks, like I'm just this real naive person. I really don't know nothing. Nobody that's 92 years old is that dumb. Nobody. If you think that, you've really been fooled in life. You're really naive to think. If you think these guys are that dumb, have you ever noticed Creflo Dollar looks like a wonderful guy? It's always smiling, I'm positive, and I get lots of money, and I'm getting what I want in life. And now he's beating his kid and strangling her. Do you think that's all he does? Do you think he cusses her? Yeah. Do I think Kenneth Copeland cusses? Yes, I do. Do I think all these guys cuss? Yes. Go online, look up T.D. Jakes, false teacher, One man says he was making passes at him over in when he was in Virginia, when he was a young preacher, and said he was a homosexual making passes at him. And when he's tried to expose him in his church, he said that T.D. Jakes went out to ruin him and get him out of the church. And then I saw T.D. Jakes one night on TV preaching on Jonathan and David. And T.D. Jakes said that when David took Jonathan into a tent and Jonathan took his coat off and gave it to David, what Jonathan was doing, Jonathan loved David. Jonathan was the son of Saul. Saul was the king of Israel. Jonathan believed that David was going to be the king because God had anointed him to be king. So Jonathan goes in and submits to David by taking his coat off, which was a custom that they did, and giving it to David saying, I'm submitting to you to be king. Even though I am Saul's son, I will not be the king. I come from the wrong tribe. I come from the tribe of Benjamin. You're from Judah. God's anointed you. T.D. Jakes said, Jonathan went in there, stripped his clothes down, took all his clothes off, and told David, you can have what you see. And then he said, we're too homophobic. Those are his exact words. That's because T.D. Jakes, I believe, is a homosexual. And I knew that night, and I was so angry that I could have bitten nails into that night when he was saying that. If I could have got into that TV and pulled him out of my den, I would have strangled him. Calling the wonderful, godly man Jonathan. Because the scripture says in 2 Samuel that their love surpassed the love of women. It didn't mean they had a sexual love. And Jonathan loved David, and he looked up to him as his king, even though his father Saul was king. He knew that David was going to be king. And he believed that. And he submitted to him. He didn't strip his clothes off and say, you can have what you see, and we're too homophobic. I despise T.D. Jakes for that one message. I would love to get that message. I took notes on it. I've got the notes on it, but I'd like to get the message. I believe he's a homosexual. He's always defending it. He plays to people. He plays to the women. He lets them have their way. Let me tell you, that man is a wicked, evil man. That one message, it just infuriated me. Talk about twisting the Word of God, and that's what men do. They twist it. There's so many stories that TBN, the Devil's Broadcasting Network, we call it DBN, is right up the street up here. The Nashville connection. They've got more connections. They used to telecast from Los Angeles, Dallas, Hendersonville, and Atlanta. Now they've moved down into Florida, and they've got a few other places they're telecasting from. But I know lots of stories about them up here. One lady came down from Michigan. She said that we were, me and Mary, walking through an antique mall up in Gallatin. That's about 10 miles up the road for those of you who don't know where Gallatin is. Was in an antique mall, and this lady said this woman came through there, and she said her husband told her that her father called her and told her. He lived here in Hendersonville. And he kept calling up there and saying, I've got to have some help. I got to have some help. She kept saying, but Dad, your house is paid for it. You got your retirement. You got money in the bank. She came down here and found out that TBN had gotten him to give his house, all of his money and everything. He was broke. I mean, the stories around here. Mary and I were walking one night back several years ago, and there was an acquaintance of ours who lives a few blocks from us. And we stopped just to stop and see how he's doing. He used to come to the church. And he had a guy cleaning his pool. And I got to talking to the guy cleaning the pool about TBN. He said, my wife used to work up there. He said she worked in the office and said that whenever they're on the phones, they will say, well, if you don't have any money, do you have any heirlooms, your grandmother's brooches, diamonds, whatever. And she said that he would come in, Paul Crouch would come in and dump that on her desk and say, appraise that and sell it. She said, just cold as she could be. These people are criminals. They belong in prison. And they do all this in the name of Jesus. And the reason government can't get them is they do it in the name of ministry for Christ. They are criminals. They're crooks. They're liars. They belong in jail, every one of them, including my younger brother. He's up there, and he's one of their big super singers. He used to be up there all the time. Don't see much anymore. They keep many young people coming in. Paul Crouch paid off one fella $400 and something thousand dollars because he had a homosexual affair with this one man, and the guy came out and told it anyway. Tried to pay him off to keep him from getting out. The amount of stories of these people, and a lot of this is documented. These people are crooks, they're liars, they're thieves. And why am I angry at them? They preach the doctrine of the devil. They promise you the moon and give you nothing. That's what they do. And they suck the life. I don't like anybody who sucks the life out of widows and orphans. I don't like bullies that beat up people. And that's what they're doing. They're browbeating the world. Most people don't listen to them and watch them. I do. I want to know where the enemy is. Paul Crouch with TVN, they bring in nearly $200 million a year. Kenneth Copeland brings in around $125 million. All you have to do is go online, these watchdog groups, and they'll tell you what these guys bring in. Joyce Myers, about 7 years ago, brought in $75 million 1 year. They bring in enormous amounts of money. They don't live like millionaires. They live like billionaires. One girl, I'm just telling you some of the stories on them. One girl told us that she worked down here at Applebee's. She said she used to work at another restaurant. Said a whole bunch of them come in, sit down at a long table, just a whole string of them, the big superstars of TBN. And she said all they talked about at their table, I bought a $200,000 Rolls. Yes, I bought a $300,000 Bentley. I got me a $150,000 Mercedes. And said they sat there at the table, and this waitress said all they did was brag on their supercars. These people are wicked. They're very evil. If you want to know what angers me, they're cheating. And there's some little lady down here on Jefferson Street. That's a poor section in Nashville. Some little black lady down there. And she's been giving them their last nickel. And she's giving them the last nickel she had to pay her light bill. And they had to turn her lights off so they can put another dollar in their coffers buying all them super homes. Some of them live in $4-5 million homes. They drive the biggest supercars you can find. One of them looks like a pimp mobile up there, and it's got gold all over the, it's a big, long, black limousine, got gold all over the gold grill, gold handles, gold all over it. It looks like he's pimping girls out of South Chicago. If I see him, I'll say, if you're going to sell that pimp car, I will tell him that. I don't like those people. They cheat the poor so they can live like a bunch of heathens. That's what the doctrine of the devil is. It's distributing fortunes. And that's what they promise you. They promise you riches, but they get it for themselves, and they give you nothing. Besides that, it's not theirs to give. Isn't that what Satan told Jesus in Luke, the 4th chapter, and Matthew, the 4th chapter? He said, fall down. He said, cast yourself down off this great precipice I'm taking you to. That's amazing, because the word Diabolos, which is another word for devil, D-I-A-B-O-L-O-S, when you find the word devil, it will either be Diabolos or it'll be D-A-I-M-O-N-I-O-N. Diabonion means to distribute fortunes. This is amazing to me. In fact, I want to go over there and look at that in just a minute. Look here. Diabolos comes from dia and balo. Balo is our word ball. It means to throw out or down. And daimonion comes from the root dio, meaning to distribute fortunes. Watch how this matches up with what Satan says in Matthew, the 4th chapter. Look at it. Watch how it matches up. Matthew 4. If you got it in for these guys, if I could blow that place up, I would. I hope God, I pray all the time that God will cause the Afghanistanians or the Iraqis, the Iranians to come over here and drop a bomb down their chimney, and I hope he'll just drop it on all of Hendersonville and blow us all up at the same time. I get to go be with the Lord, and they're headed for hell. Look here in Matthew, the fourth chapter. Two chapters are sister chapters. You're going to find this, see sister chapters all through the Gospels. Matthew 4, and you're going to see the two concepts of devil. Anytime you find, demon is not in your Bible. This is our word demon right here, daimonion. It's not in a King James Bible. When you look in a concordance, you're not going to find the word demon there. It'll always be the word devil, and it'll be translated either from diabolos meaning to cast out or down, and the word daemonion, it'll be one of these two. You have to look it up and find out which one it is. But look at the concept here in Matthew 4. It's spelled out for us. Matthew 4. Now, Jesus has just been washed in water by John the Baptist in chapter 3. In chapter 4, Jesus goes into the wilderness to be tempted, and he's going to preach his first sermon on the Mount, which will be the Sermon on the Mount, Northern Galilee, in the 5th chapter, and it'll go from 5 through 7. But here in chapter 4, he's being cleansed in the wilderness. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, "If thou be the Son of God," do you think Satan believed he was the Son of God? There was no if to it. He knew that he was the Son of God. He said, "Command that these stones to be made bread." And he answered and said, Jesus answered Satan and says, "It is written in Deuteronomy the 8th chapter." That's where it's quoted from. "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God." That's out of Deuteronomy 8. "Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city," or Jerusalem, "and setteth him upon the pinnacle of a temple, and saith unto him, If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down." Diabolos. Cast down is the very meaning of this sentence here. That's the word diabolos. It's the same in the Greek as it is in the Italian, as it is in the Spanish. The Cisco Kid had a horse named Diabolo. Remember that? He's the devil. Then he says, "And saith unto him, If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down." Or you could just bit Diabolos there, one of the words for devil. "For it is written, He shall give his angels charge concerning thee." This is out of the 91st Psalm that the devil's quoting. Can the devil quote the Bible? You bet your life. Can wicked false teachers quote the Bible? Oh, yeah. Once in a while, Kenneth Copeland would be preaching, and I would go, "Oh, wow, he's saying some truth there." And I say, "Oh, he's quoting the Bible. That's what it is." He can quote the Bible and then go to hell. And even if he quotes the Bible, it won't return void. And he'll be a false teacher and a liar and go to hell. "He shall give his angels charge over thee in their hands, and they shall bear thee up, in lest thou at any time dash thy foot against the stone." And Jesus said, "It is written again, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God." And again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of him. And he said unto him, "All these things will I distribute unto you. All these fortunes of the world will I distribute unto you." The two meanings for the word devil, diabolos, daemonion, are right here. Do you think that's an accident? No. "All these things will I give unto thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me." Now, you know what he was doing? He was pulling a Kenneth Copeland. He was promising Jesus something that wasn't his to give, wasn't he? Who owned it? Jesus owned it. He owns the cattle on a thousand hills. He's telling Jesus, "I'm going to give to you what you own already." It's like some guy coming off the street say, "I'd like to give you that pickup truck." I said, "It's already mine." "Well, I want to give it to you. All you have to do is give me money. Fall down and worship me." See, he's saying, this is what Copeland and company is saying. They're saying, "Fall down and worship me, and I'll give you fortunes." No, they won't, and God won't. It's amazing how people will follow them 20 and 30 years, and their ship, they're waiting for their ship to come in, and it sunk a long time ago. In fact, it never did come out of port. Then said Jesus unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve." Now, in every one of the Gospels, you'll have a sister chapter in here and one over here. The sister, we've talked about that, about prophecy chapters. You've got Matthew 24 as a prophecy chapter. Mark, the 13th chapter, is the sister chapter to Matthew 24. The sister chapter to these two chapters in Luke is Luke 21. And you got those three chapters. You got the sister chapters of the man of the Gadarenes in Mark, in Matthew 8, Mark 5, and Luke 8. 8, 5, and 8. Matthew, Mark, Luke, 8, 5, 8. You got the man of the Gadarenes, and you really have to read each account to get the full understanding, because Matthew will say something that Mark doesn't say, and Mark will say something that Luke doesn't say. Mark will say something that Matthew doesn't say, and Luke will say something that Matthew and Mark don't say. Always study the sister chapters. Always. Now, the sister chapter is over here in Luke 4. Remember, Matthew 4, Luke 4. That's how you find the sister chapter. On this text here. And if you'll notice, everything follows in a sequence. After Matthew 4 is Matthew 5, isn't it? Naturally. Well, Matthew 5 is where the Sermon on the Mount starts. In Luke 4, you have the same account as Matthew 4. And then the Sermon on the Mount in Luke is Luke 6. So always the Sermon on the Mount is going to come after this right here. Because this is right after Jesus is washed in water. And that was a proselyte baptism. Now look over here in Luke. And why would Jesus put this down twice? Two witnesses. Two witnesses is Jewish law. He puts it in here twice to verify. Now, we may read the same thing and we may see something different. Look here in Luke 4. Luke 4. I just want you to see this and see how you've got it in here twice. All right. Luke 4. And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, being 40 days tempted of the devil. In those days he did eat nothing. When they were ended, he afterward hungered. The devil said unto him, If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. Saying the same thing, isn't he? And Jesus answered him, saying, It is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. And the devil, taking him up into a high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, All this power will I give thee, and all the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will give it. But it wasn't his to give, was it? It's not Kenneth Copeland's to promise you what he'll give. This is Kenneth Copeland's Jesus, J-E, dollar sign, U, dollar sign. That's his S, is a dollar sign. And the devil said unto him, All this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, that whomsoever I will give it. And if thou wilt worship me, all shall be thine. And Jesus said, Get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, Thou shalt not worship the Lord. Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Now, did you notice, if you only read Luke 4, he doesn't say cast yourself down. So you got to get to Matthew 4 to see the casting down or the casting out, and that's the meaning of the word diabolos. So Luke does, because Luke doesn't say it, doesn't mean it's not here in Luke. It meant Luke didn't say it, but Matthew said both of them. Matthew defines in Matthew 4, diabolos and daemonion. Luke only defines daemonion, I'll give you the fortunes of the world. That's why you've got to read both of them. And sometimes one will say something the other doesn't say. So always look at your sister chapters. And usually it'll be some chronology to it. There'll be chronology to the chapters. If you're at the end of Matthew, if Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John are the life story of Jesus, then I guess at the end of these books, you're going to have his death and resurrection, aren't you? So you got to go somewhere up around chapter 26, 27 of Matthew to get you into, and then 28, and you're going to have to go. So this has to be where the cross is over here in 26, 27, 28, and the resurrection has to be in there. And then when you get over to Mark, you got 16 chapters in Mark. You got Mark, and Jesus is being crucified in that. He's being taken the 14th chapter and crucified in the 15th chapter and resurrects at the end of the 15th chapter and the beginning of the 16th chapter. And the same thing with Luke. You get into Luke and you see Jesus having the last Passover in the 22nd chapter. He's crucified in the 23rd chapter. The resurrection in the 24th chapter. So always keep in mind the structure of Scripture so you'll know where you're going. Well, we know that at the beginning of the book, you've got him being washed in water, which is a proselyte baptism, and then he's going into the wilderness. Satan's tempting him, and you get the two definitions for daemon and diabolos. But you also have the two definitions of daemon and diabolos in Genesis, the third chapter, don't you? Huh? Sure you do. You have, let me just say it again. I've said it before. It's amazing how this stuff works together if you evaluate and analyze it. It just takes analysis. Eve goes to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Tree, knowledge, good and evil. And here's what the Bible says. Let's look at it. Genesis 3rd chapter. I didn't mean to get into this like this, but I really want you to see these things. Genesis 3 and 1 John 2:16. Look at them together. Do like I do and hold your Bible in two places. 1 John 2:16, 17. Now, I've read this, but I want you to read it with me because there's nothing... I've said this before. If you're talking to someone about predestination, don't just quote it, especially if you're having a hard time with them. If you sit across the table from somebody and you quote Romans 8, 29, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son, people usually think you're paraphrasing. And you've twisted it to mean, make it mean, if you get it exactly verbatim, they still are going to accuse you of paraphrasing. They're still going to say, well, that's your opinion. What they mean by your opinion, you quote it the way you want to quote it, even though you get it exactly the way it is. I don't ever, if I'm dealing with somebody that's hard to deal with, I do not. Here's what I do. I go around to their side of the table. I sit down with their side of the table. I open my Bible and I say, look here with me. See right here, verse 29. For whom he did foreknow. You see that? He also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son. Can you see that? And look over here in Romans 9:13. When Rebekah had conceived, now I want you to watch with me. That's all the way I never sat across the table and quote when I'm dealing with somebody that's having a hard time saying. I never do that. I'll quote verbatim out in public, but I'll sit down beside them if I really want them to see it. What scares people is not you quoting it. What scares them is to look at it and see it in this book. It scares them. I've had people argue with me until they sit down and I made them look at the book. They'll say, what kind of Bible is it? Well, is that a cult book? Well, it's a King James Bible. It's Thomas Chain Reference. KJV. You got one there in your hand. I always tell them that. I'll go real slow and point it out to them. That's what you have to do to get people to pay attention. Don't let them take your words. Make them look at it. You understand what I'm saying? There's nothing like looking at the Word of God. Don't matter how proficient you are, how well you can quote it. I don't care if you quote the whole chapter. It doesn't really mean that much to them. They think you're twisting it and making it sound the way you want it to. That's what you have to do to get people to really get convicted. You got family, friends, wife, husband, kids. You want them to see something, make them look at it. There's nothing like it. I've had people just stop them dead in their tracks where they'd been arguing with me before. Now, where was I? Okay, 1 John. Now, we're looking at Diabolos and Daemon in Genesis. I give this all the time because this is so powerful. The first place you find Diabolos and Daemonion is in the 3rd chapter of Genesis. That's the first place you find it. You find it in concept. Now, 1 John 2:16. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, I'm reading it. I can quote this, but I'm reading it. And the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. He says, these three things are not of God, they're of the world. Then let's look at Genesis, the 3rd chapter, and verse 6. Well, when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise. The first good for food is the lust of the flesh. Pleasant to the eyes is the lust of the eye. And to make her wise, that's the pride of life. When a person is wise in their own eyes, they have all that's in the world. And she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her and did eat. Now, there's daimonion distributing fortunes, isn't it? There's the concept of daimonion. All that's in the world, lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, and pride of life. That's what Eve saw. And it's amazing, there's three things. In a demon, daimonion, what the Jews call daimonion or demons, the Arabs call genies. J-I-N-N is plural for genie, jinn. And daimonion, this is what the Jews call demons. The Arabs call genies. And the Jews said demons were ancestors, and they deified them as gods. Well, these ancestors, remember the word daimonion was interchangeable with the word theos in the first century. Theos is the, we say theology, that means theos logos, the word of God, study of the word of God, that's theology. Well, a demon was an ancestor, and that is a person's genes, isn't it? And when you look up genie, it comes from the word gene. And the word genos is a variation of that, genos. And genos means kinfolk. And what the Arabs called genies and the Jews called demons, the Celts called fairies. If you believe in demons, you have to believe in fairies and you have to believe in genies, because they're all the same thing in different cultures. You have to. If you look up fairies in McClintock and Strong, or look up fairies in Hastings, it'll tell you they're the same thing. They interchange the word demon and fairy and guardian angel. What does a guardian angel do? What do you get from a fairy? We're not talking about those guys in San Francisco. Well, you get what? You get wishes. How many wishes do you get from a genie? You get three. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, pride of life. That's how many you get. And this is where it comes from. Genies and demons are the same. It's the same thing as totem among the American Indian. In fact, not just the American Indian. I've got many books on genies and fairies and where they come from. Totems are in every system of the world. And totem means kinfolk. And when Jesus said, this kind goeth not out by prayer and fasting, in the 17th chapter of Matthew, the word kind is genos. It means kinfolk. He's not, I've said this before, do we have something in our body that comes from our kinfolk that wants to distribute fortunes? Do we have something in us? Do we have an ancestor in us that wants to distribute fortunes? Lust of the flesh? Where'd we get this? Eve? Adam? Well, yeah. We're all kin to Adam and Eve. We have the lust of the flesh in us, don't we? It's so amazing how the truth and a lie is so parallel. They actually believed they were literal gods that come down. They weren't literal gods. They were self. Jesus said demons were self. When he rebuked him, the man with the unclean spirit, in Mark, the first chapter, he rebuked A-U-T-O. Auto is the word self. Now, they have very, very variable endings to it. If they have A-U-T-Ada, then that is feminine gender. And they would translate that her, but her is a form of self. She is a form of self. He is a form of self. My is a form of self. Anything that refers to the flesh is a form of self, especially if it's going after the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, or going after the three wishes. That's where it all goes back to. And the American Indian called it totem. The Greeks called the same thing. What did the Greeks call them? Does anybody remember? No. They called them guardian angels. What does a guardian angel do? Distributes fortunes. It guides you to good fortune. It's like a fortune teller. Do you go down to the fortune teller and they say, I cross my palm with money now. with silver. Now, let me read your fortune. Okay, you're going to leave here, then you're going to drive out the driveway. You're going to go around here, down the road here, and you're going to run through this light, and a semi truck's going to hit you, and you're going to die and go to hell. Okay, now. Do they always tell you bad fortune? No, they tell you good fortune, don't they? They don't tell you you're going to get cancer and die in 6 months. They don't ever tell you bad fortune. They tell you good fortune. So the Greeks called them guardian angel. Well, what does the Roman Catholics call them? Patron saint. Patron saint. And the patron saint of children is who? Huh? Saint Nicholas. And what does he do for children? He distributes fortunes to them, doesn't he? Daemonion. He distributes fortune. I don't know why people don't understand this. He's the patron saint of children. He distributes fortune. Some people believe that St. Nicholas of Myra during the 4th century was a pedophile because he kept toys around for kids all the time and he's enticing them to come into his home and giving them fortunes. He's been accused of being a pedophile. Whenever I wrote this St. Nicholas track over here and I put it in the paper, they called me and said, Mr. Brown, we're going to have to put a disclaimer on this. You're calling Santa Claus a demon. We got to put something that disclaims it. I said, fine. I like disclaimers. I'd like to have disclaimers on everything that I preach. Because that way people go, what in the world are they disclaiming this for? And the elect, if they go to it, they say, oh, this is right. I mean, don't matter. Put disclaimers on everything. Say, this station is not necessarily in agreement with the things that are taught here in this lesson. Now, go to it. When people say, I'm going to ruin you. I'm going to tell people to not have anything to do with ministry. I had a young Catholic told me, I'm going to ruin you in Hendersonville. I said, be sure and tell them not to watch us on Thursday night at 7 o'clock. Don't watch this guy at 7 o'clock on Thursday night. Because if the elect watch it, I don't care how many disclaimers people put on us. In fact, I like disclaimers on everything. It provokes the elect to look, doesn't it? Yeah, I have. Tuesday, Channel 3. Yes. So, where was I? And what does the Romans call them? What does the Romans call genius? The Romans call them genius. And a genius is a gifted person, isn't it? That has special fortunes. When you're gifted as a genius, you got potential wealth, don't you? Madonna's got an IQ of about 155. She could have been a neurosurgeon or heart surgeon if she wanted to, but instead she wants to look like a fool. Jane Mansfield had an IQ of 150. She wanted to be a sex symbol instead of the brilliance that she had. Reggie Jackson's got an IQ of 160. He could have been anything he wanted to be. But he liked to hit baseballs. There's people out there that your genius doesn't mean you're going to go out there and pursue it. You may just say, man, I love to sing. I had a guy play guitar for me one time, played bass for me one time. His father was a nuclear physicist at Cape Kennedy, and his brother was at the Houston complex down there, and he was a physicist down there, and he wanted... The guy was brilliant. If he opened his mouth, he wasn't trying to show off. He had such an unbelievable vocabulary that all these things would come out of his mouth. And I'd say, do you not know that you have a gift to do something? I want to play bass in a band. It doesn't mean because somebody has a gift that they pursue it. And it don't mean because you can do something, you're supposed to be doing it. But I just thought it was funny. I couldn't get him to say anything plain. One time, he would express how he didn't like a particular hamburger, and he used all these big words to express, and you couldn't even tell what he's saying. I said, are you trying to say that hamburger ain't no good? I said, why don't you say this hamburger ain't no good? He said, I can't say that. I said, come on, tell me the hamburger ain't no good. I want to hear you say that. Finally, he said, this hamburger ain't no good. Oh, he thought he was cursing, you know. And why people do the things they do, I don't know. Now, so the Romans, so all of this, that's what all this is. what they've taken all of this, and the charismatics say there's real demons. Well, that seems to be a ploy to get the idea off the real demons, which is distributing fortunes, to say that a demon is an entity that comes and lives in your body, and that's what they said it was. That it was something, some spirit that come and got in your body and made you go, and fall on the floor and act like a fool and start spitting green pea soup or something. If you notice, when they first started doing this, demons talking like this was when The Exorcist came out in 1973. Nobody exercised people like that before, where there's, They actually picked up exercising demons from a Hollywood producer who says, this is what it looks like. Insane. Now, we're talking about these guys who preach this distributing fortunes. And a demon is self. It's not some entity. If you believe in demons, you have to believe in genies. They're the same thing in two different cultures. The Arabs said that Solomon was master of the genies. And the Jews said that Solomon was master of the demons. Where did they come up with that? The same thing. The Arab said he's master of the genies. Jews said he's master of the demons. Well, genie gives you the wishes. That's distributing fortunes. And you get from a demon distributing fortunes. But it's all self. Genie comes from the word gene. Oh, by the way, when you look up the word wish in a Webster's dictionary, now all of this started at Babel. The reason it all started at Babel, which was the first Babylonian dynasty, is because Babel was the reinstitution of tree worship of the garden, or all that's in the world. This is after the flood, at Babel. Well, Revelation 17 and 5 says, Babylon mothered all harlotry. That's because this was after the flood, and they merely reinstituted this worship. Where did that come from? It had to have come from the wife of Ham. It had to have come from that. Because Noah has three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. And Ham's grandson is Nimrod. And Nimrod started the Babylonian system, and he was deified as virgin born. And all the gods of the ancient world, Nimrod is nothing but the demon of self. When they would take these great, 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 great grandparents, they would deify them as gods. And in every society of the world, they would give them different names. Hercules over here in Rome. Hercules was called a demon or a daemonion. And over here in Babylon, he was called Tammuz. And they all had similar characteristics. And I've gone through all this. And if you went over here to Rome, he was called Jupiter. And they had many different forms of him. And they had the female consorts. They had Hercules and Venus and so forth. So all of this goes back here. When you look up the word wish, and the consort of Nimrod, whether she was Semiramis or whether she was the queen of heaven, she was called Venus. Mr. Hislop tells us that. And when you look up the word wish in Webster's dictionary, it tells you it's a Latin word, Venus. And three wishes come from the genie. Now, I've got dozens of books on demons. You can go into you can go into Hastings. That's the best set of books to find out what demons are. And you look up Fairies, you look up Totem, you can look up, and they'll tell you sea animism. You go into all these different things, and they'll tell you what they were in different cultures and different societies. If you're talking about demons, you're talking about genies. If there's no such thing as genies, there's no such thing as demons. They're the same thing in different societies. You can't believe in one without believing in the other. They're the same thing. If you believe in Hercules, you got to believe in Tammuz. They were nothing but the deification of Nimrod turned into gods. When they said, may the gods go with you, they said, may the demons go with you, or may the demonion go with you. And they called Augustus Caesar in the first century a good demon. Why? He distributed the fortunes of the world to the people of Rome, of the Roman Empire. They called him a good demon, and that's why when the rich young ruler came to Jesus in Mark the 10th chapter, and he said, what good thing shall I do that I may have everlasting life? And Jesus said, why callest thou me good? There's none good but God. If I am good, I am God. Well, to call anyone good besides Caesar was treason. You could die for that. So that's why Jesus said what he said. If I am good, I am God. And then he goes on further into it. Now, we're talking about these guys. I've got so many papers on false teachers, false prophets. I've got hundreds and hundreds of verses on false teaching, false prophets, what God's going to do to them from one end of the Bible to the other. And yet I never, ever hear anybody in the world talk about false teachers. That's why people get angry at me when I talk about these false teachers. Because nobody believes anybody's bad out here that says J-E-S-U-S with their mouth. But there's another Jesus, another spirit, another gospel. Now, I've been talking about these guys. I've been reading things to you about them. How do they preach false doctrine and get people to listen? They use Christian terminology. They use the word prayer. They use the word saved. They use the name Jesus. They use the word gospel. They use the word salvation. They don't use the word repent hardly. You don't ever hear that. You don't hear David Cross. You don't hear death to self. You don't hear self-denial. I never hear that from these preachers. None of them. I never hear one of them talk about false prophets or false teachers. Does anybody hear him talk about them? I don't mean anybody. It's Jesus wants you to have a good life. He wants to distribute fortunes to you. When they say that, he wants you to have a good time, an easy life, and everything that you want. God doesn't want that. How's he going to crush self by letting you be comfortable? If you're comfortable and he doesn't bring trials and tribulation to your life, what's going to make you bow to him? If you have all the money you want, all the health you want, all the happiness you want. There's nothing going to make you bow to God when you have everything you want, is there? You'll never bow. He's got to give you a health problem. He's got to make you sick. People say, God wouldn't make anybody sick. I heard Benny Hinn one night said, God doesn't make anybody sick. He said, I dare anyone to show me where God makes anybody sick. How about Micah 6:13? Therefore will I make thee sick in smiting thee because of thy sins. God says, I'll make you sick. And they say, God won't make anybody sick. He says, I'll bring pestilence and famine and plague and I'll kill you. That's permanent sickness, isn't it? God killed 70,000 innocent people in Israel because David numbered Israel in that 24th chapter of 1 Samuel. And God provoked him to number Israel. Why did he do that? Because in the 23rd chapter, David was bragging on all of his mighty men and he was taking credit for winning all the battles that he had. He had 1,800,000 men in his army, and God says, I'm going to start striking people dead for you taking credit. But he made him number Israel because in that 23rd chapter, he is bragging about all these great mighty men of valor he had, as though it was these mighty men that had conquered all of their enemies, when at one point, David had only had 400 to 600 men in his army when Saul was chasing him across Israel trying to kill him. And every time David would be backed into a corner, at one point David got backed into a corner behind a mountain and it looked like Saul was going to slaughter him. And all of a sudden a runner came in and said, the Philistines are attacking Jerusalem. He said, come on men, let's get out of here. Who do you think caused the Philistines to do that so that David could get out of there? And David seemed to have forgotten that when he started bragging on all of his mighty men and said, I did this by my power. Guys, if David could commit adultery and murder, which he did when he had an affair with Bathsheba, you think you couldn't? When he pulled this trick and he had Uriah the Hittite take the message into battle and said, take this to Joab, my commander, my nephew, and says, put Uriah the Hittite in the battle and withdraw from him so he'll be killed. Do you think that you could do that? I didn't believe I could do some of the sin I did till I got off out in the music business. And then got opened, wide open temptation. There's no temptation taking me but such as is common to you. There's no temptation taking you but such as is common to man. But God will with this temptation make a way of escape. Do you think you could do things that bad? You mean you are that much far above the king of Israel, David? And after David repented and God forgave him, he was a man after God's own heart, and then he numbered Israel. And then God started killing people in Israel. And he tells David, people say God won't make anybody sick. Well, like I said, when he kills people, that's permanent illness. Look at the 24th chapter of 1 Samuel. No. Oh, yeah, excuse me. 2 Samuel, not 1 Samuel. I'm sorry, you're right. 2 Samuel. I'm going to be over there with Saul chasing David. 2 Samuel, you're right. 24th chapter. And God provokes David to number Israel because David is numbering all of his mighty men in that 23rd chapter, talking about how great they are. He talks about Abishai, the brother of Joab, in verse 18, the son of Zeruiah, David's sister, was chief among the three. He lifted up his spear against 300 and slew them. He's talking about Abishai killing 300 men. Abishai was David's constant companion. Was he not most honorable of thee before? Therefore, he was their captain, and he goes on down to Benaiah, the son of Jehoiada, how valiant he was, and how he went down and slew a lion in the midst of the pit in the snow. David's bragging on his mighty men, and he's got 1,800,000 in his army. In verse 1, and again, the anger of the Lord was kindled against David, and he moved David against them to say, go number Israel and Judah. And so David is starting to take credit with these 1,800,000 men. Then God comes to David and says, because you did this and because you took the credit, there was a time you didn't have 400 men in your army and Saul had thousands chasing you, and I delivered everywhere you went. This, sometimes we forget who God is and how he delivers us after we get successful, don't we? God says, I'll stop you and I'll show you who I am. He's done that to me. Has he done it to you? You go along, your life is smooth and everything's hunky-dory and it's great. Then God strikes you. As you think you've succeeded, watch what I'll do. I'll crush self out of you. I've said this, we all start off as little boys, and then we get to be grown, big, arrogant, important men, and then God has to take us back to being a little boy again. Until he brings you back to a little boy, and you're going, I don't know what God's going to do next. I'll just better commit to him. If it's dig a ditch, I'll just dig a ditch. God, I want to do what you want me to do. This is actually what happens to our life. He says we have to become as little children. We start off humble. Then we get mature physically. And we get arrogant. And then he has to humble us back and turn all of us men back to little boys. Little boys and women back to little girls. That's what he has to do. And the older you get, you realize what a little boy you are, don't you? There's no such thing as adults and children. There's just children and older children. That's all there is. You think, I'll tell you what, and you guys know that's been up. I've been at Minot, North Dakota in a blizzard. I've been in Grand Forks in a blizzard. And you know what happens to bankers and doctors in a blizzard? They turn into little boys. They go, did you see what the temperature is? the guy who's normally president of the bank. I've been in a hurricane with businessmen, and I've been in one of the worst blizzards that ever hit the north back in 72, 73, and it dropped to 89 below wind chill factor. It was about 40 below. I'd never been that cold in my life, and my bones got frozen, and I couldn't get warm. I was in Tennessee another month before I got warm again. Whew. And grown men start acting like children, don't they? When you get in something that's bad, that terrifies you, and the winds were 55 miles an hour, and you couldn't step away from the... We stayed in that motel for 5 days and nights, and the people that owned the hotel had to feed us. I was terrified. Nothing has ever scared me like that in my life. I got out the end of my van. I said, I want to see what this is like. And I stepped about 3 or 4 feet away from my van, and I started losing my equilibrium. I grabbed for the van, pulled myself back, went back into the room. I stayed in there. We had to walk down the walkway and go around to the end of the motel so the people that owned the motel could feed us for 5 days and nights. It is scary. And watch grown men. I was in a hurricane in Texas during Hurricane Audrey in 57, and it killed 500 people in Cameron, Louisiana. And there were businessmen in there, and I was 17. They was going 17, 18. Have you heard anything? And they turn into children. That's why I love thunderstorm and see lightning crashing across the sky. I said, that's my God that's doing that. And I know it humbles men who are mature. Right in the middle of their life, they're, I'm a businessman. That is until a hurricane comes. And then watch him turn into a little kid. Or when a man has had it all and he goes broke. I've seen that too. Jim, I used to have lots of money, and I don't have it anymore. How arrogant were you when you had the money? And he says here in verse 13, so Gad the prophet came to David, chapter 24, 2 Samuel, and told him and said unto him, I'll give you a choice of three things, either the sword, the famine, or the pestilence. Remember, those are the first three judgments that God brought on Israel while they were a nation for 500 years. Sword, famine, pestilence, and then the beast would be Babylon, Persia, Greece, and Rome to carry Israel into captivity. God names three things, and he says, David, I'm going to give you a choice, which you want for having numbered Israel. And Gad came to David and told him and said unto him, shall 7 years of famine, there's the first judgment, isn't it? Come up on you, David. Come unto thee and upon thy land, or wilt thou flee 3 months before thine enemies, the sword, while they pursue thee, or that there be 3 days of pestilence? There's the sword, the famine, the pestilence, isn't it? We find that all through the Old Testament, don't we? All the way through. I preached on that 1,000 times, and the final judgment was the beast. He said, David, you can pick the one of these that you want. You get one of them, but you have to take one. Now advise me, David, what do you want me to do to you? How would you like to have that choice? The living God is saying, I give you this choice, the sword, the famine, the pestilence. You're going to be able to, there'll be 7 years of famine. Your enemies will, you'll flee from your enemies 3 months, and they'll slaughter you. Or would you like to turn yourself over to me with a pestilence in thy land? Now advise and see what answer I shall return to him that sent me. This is what Gad is saying to David. You get a choice. Oh, you're not going to get 3 wishes from the genie this time. You're going to get a choice of 3. And David said unto Gad, I am in a great strait. I guess so. Let us fall now into the hand of the Lord with pestilence, for his mercies are great. And let not me fall in the hand of man with all of this, these men chasing me. He said, I'm in this strait. So the Lord sent a pestilence upon Israel. The Lord sent a pestilence. The Lord sent a pestilence. Kenneth Copeland says God won't make anybody sick. What is a pestilence? It's a disease. It's cancer, it's AIDS, it's Ebola, it's smallpox, it's This is enough disease to kill a lot of people, and God kills them. Whenever they say God won't make anybody sick, they twist and wrench the word of God, don't they? Right here, you think God's making these people sick? I guess so. He's fixing to kill a whole bunch of them. So the Lord sent, not the devil sent, the Lord sent a pestilence upon Israel from the morning even to the time appointed, and there died of the people from Dan, the most northern city in Israel, to Beersheba, the most southern city in Israel, 70,000 innocent men who hadn't done anything. That's who they are. God killed 70,000 innocent people because of David's rebellion for taking credit for all that happened in Israel. And charismatics say, God won't make anybody sick. These men were permanently sick from then on. And when the angel stretched out his hand upon Jerusalem to destroy it, probably Michael the archangel. Michael was God's death angel. He came down one night in that 19th chapter of 2 Kings and killed 185,000 men in one night. When the angel of the Lord stretched out his hand upon Jerusalem to destroy it, the Lord repented him. Repent doesn't mean he found an aisle in a Baptist church and walked down the aisle. Repent means to turn. God turned himself from the evil that he was doing. God's doing the evil, isn't he? And said to the angel that destroyed the people, that's enough, you've killed enough people, stop. Now who's doing this killing? It's by the order of God, isn't it? Stay now thine hand, and the angel of the Lord was by the threshing floor of Araunah the Jebusite. David goes to Araunah and says, I want to buy this threshing floor. And Araunah says, I'll give it to you. That was the Jewish custom to say, I'll give it to you. When Abraham was going to buy the cave of Machpelah, the man he was buying it from said, I'll give it to you. That doesn't mean they want to give it to you. That was a way of saying, what are you going to offer me for it? Because nobody took it for free. That was the way they dealt. They'd say, I'll give it to you. And what is it that David says let's look at Araunah, verse 18. And Gad came that day to David and said unto him, go up, rear an altar unto the Lord in the threshing floor of Araunah, the Jebusite. And David, according to the saying of Gad, went up, as the Lord commanded, and Araunah looked and saw the king and his servants coming on toward him. And Araunah went out and bowed himself before the king on his face upon the ground. And Araunah said, there, wherefore is my king, my lord the king, coming to his servant? And David said, to buy the threshing floor of thee, to build an altar unto the Lord, that the plague may be stayed from the people. And Araunah said unto David, let my lord the king take and offer up what seemeth good unto him. Behold, here be oxen for burnt sacrifice, threshing instruments, and other instruments of oxen for wood. You got the wood, you got the sacrifice here. All these things did Araunah as a king give unto the king. And Araunah said unto the king, the Lord thy God accept thee. And the king said unto Araunah, no, I'm not taking anything for free, but I will surely buy it of thee at a price. And I love these next words. Neither will I offer burnt offerings unto the Lord my God of that which doth cost me nothing. It is not sacrifice if it doesn't cost. If you're here just for a free ride and it don't cost you anything, some people will come and they give me my free DVDs and I want to come and get the free message, but I'm not giving to Grace and Truth. Well, keep your money. I don't want it if God don't deal with you. But it's not sacrifice. And until you learn to sacrifice, your life's not going to be happy. That's what the Bible says. David says, I don't offer anything to God of that which doth cost me nothing. It has to cost. It's not sacrifice otherwise. Now, we're talking about these false prophets and false teachers. People get mad at me because I am angry with these lying false teachers that steal from the poor. I've been reading to you, I think I've got a piece of paper up here. But I've been reading to you some of the things about Billy Graham. People think, how in the world can Billy Graham be a false teacher? Well, it's real easy. He doesn't tell the truth. The Baptists don't tell the truth today. These Baptists today, I don't know how they get in heaven. The Baptists 150 years ago preached that Christmas was pagan, that Easter was pagan, that predestination was true. The most famous Baptist preacher of the 1800s was a man named Charles Spurgeon. And the Baptists today say, oh, he's our mentor and he's our great icon. Charles Spurgeon wrote so many books, and his books would cover from about here over to that wall. Every page had predestination written in it. Charles Spurgeon believed in predestination, the sovereignty of God. He said that Christmas was wickedness. He hated Christmas and Easter, Ishtar. He believed in a daily cross and self-denial. And yet, these Baptists say he is our teacher and our mentor. You hadn't read his books. He says that man doesn't have free will, that God has free will. And the Baptist preachers today are like Billy Graham. Billy Graham preaches, accept Christ, that's not true. He preaches a sinner's prayer for salvation, that's not true. He says that born again is a walk down the aisle. That's not true. God births people, he births whom he wills. He quickens whom he wills. He makes alive who he wills to make alive. And the ones he wills to make alive are his elect family that he preordained for the foundation of the world. These preachers, anything they preach on, if you have predestination wrong in your message, everything else is wrong in your message. Everything. You cannot be wrong on predestination and have anything else right because you got another Jesus. That's a work of salvation to walk down an aisle and pray a prayer, and that's going to get you into heaven. That's a work of salvation, isn't it? I have to pray this prayer. First of all, the main thing about predestination, you have to remember. There's a couple of things you need to remember about predestination, but particularly the reason for predestination, God has to predestine a family because men are wicked. There is none that seeketh after God there in Romans, the 3rd chapter. Nobody seeks God. If nobody seeks God, how are men going to come to Christ? They have to be drawn to him. These people who preach any other doctrine than predestination, the sovereignty of God, it's false doctrine. I can't fellowship with free will people. There's been some predestination to say, well, these are godly people too. I don't know that I believe that. I don't really believe that. You cannot believe the Bible and not believe in predestination and not believe that God has chosen his family and not believe that God is drawing his people to him. No man can come to me. I like that part of the verse, John 6:44. No man can come to me. Just stop right there. Unless God sent me, draw him. Draw, helko, means to drag in. If God doesn't drag a man in, screaming against his will, he's not coming. So anybody who preaches free will, accept Christ, sinner's prayer, that's the doctrine of the devil. And they do that to make an easy life for people. Unless God drags them in, they're not coming. Billy Graham embraces everything and everybody. He's embraced every president, Roman Catholic presidents like John Kennedy, heathen presidents like Ronald Reagan. Oh, Ronald Reagan's a Christian. Ronald Reagan's not a Christian. He serves another Jesus. George Bush, he serves another Jesus. Billy Graham says Bill Clinton needs to be an evangelist. He says he's got the personality for it. What, he's going to take all of his women with him? That'd be great. Be an evangelist. He holds a Los Angeles crusade, and he's got all of his groupies out there that he goes and sleeps with. Then he goes to somewhere up in Minnesota, up at St. Paul, or goes into Minneapolis, and he's got his groupies up there. That's what we need, is a preacher like that. Billy Graham believes in everybody. He embraces the Roman Catholic Church. He says if you're a Buddhist, if you're a Hindu, and you do the things of Christ in that religion, you get to go to heaven. I've been reading this paper on him. Let me read a couple of the things. He embraces Roman Catholicism. He has them sponsor his crusades. And whenever he has them, sponsors crusades. The Catholics, he gives the cards to the people that walk the aisle and tells them to go back to their diocese. The Jews, he tells them to go back to their synagogues. Let me read a little more that I've got here on this. I'm about to run out of time. On 3598 on the Today Show, Graham said about Clinton's sexual escapades, "I forgive him because I know the frailty of human nature." You're not supposed to forgive anybody unless they repent. If your brother trespasses against you, rebuke him, and if he repent, forgive him. You don't forgive people out of the clear blue sky. There's no such thing as free forgiveness. And I know how hard it is, and especially a strong, vigorous young man like he is. He has such a tremendous personality. That's an excuse for allowing him to go out and sleep around, isn't it? I think the ladies just go wild over him. Is that, that's outrageous, isn't it? That's outrageous. Oh, the women go wild over him, and I excuse him for that. Billy, you're a foolish man. More of Graham's ecumenism is in his statement of U.S. News and World Report, 12-1988. "World travel and getting to know clergy of all denominations has helped mold me into an ecumenical being. We're separated by theology, theos logos, the word of God. And in some instances, culture and race, but all of that means nothing to me anymore." He's saying doctrine doesn't mean anything, yet the Bible says if anybody preaches any other doctrine, don't bid them Godspeed, don't bring them into your house, have nothing to do with them, separate from them. I can't believe this guy. Yet the world will see me say this, "You're just bitter and you're angry. You're ignorant." Ignorant means unlearned. You don't know what's going on. If you don't know Paul Crouch is a thief, you're sick. You don't investigate these guys. If you don't know that Benny Hinn is a crook, you're not investigating him. If you know that Fred Price is one of the biggest liars in the world, Fred Price is a snake oil salesman. Creflo Dollar is a child beater. I believe they all beat their children if they get a chance. They're all medicine men. Medicine men used to travel the Old West, and they'd go into a town with an old wagon, and they'd pull all kinds of tricks on the people, and they'd sell a bottle of elixir, and it's supposed to cure everything from cancer to ingrown toenails to dishpan hands to whatever, heart trouble. It's called snake oil. That's what they are. They're selling you an elixir that they can't deliver. This should not surprise us in the light of the fact that as early as 1958, Graham had reduced the doctrine of verbal inerrancy to the status of mere theory and denied that this particular theory of inspiration was even essential to Christian orthodoxy, let alone grounds for breaking of Christian fellowship. A pastor who attended a Graham crusade in September the 22nd, 1990, in Nassau Coliseum on Long Island, reported his experience as follows. Now, here's a preacher that reported his experience. "I have read often of the compromises of Billy Graham, but doubted some of the stories as exaggerated. Now they have been proven, in my eyes, worse than reported. My conclusion is that Billy Graham is making men twofold more the child of hell. The emphasis was on believing in God with little commentary on Jesus Christ, but very little. We were told that the way to take care of sin problem is to receive Christ, rededicate your life, or renew your confirmation vows, or whatever you call it in your church." If it's a Catholic church, if you're confirmation, you just renew those vows. "Or whatever you call it. I could hardly believe my ears. What do confirmation vows have to do with salvation?" When you have your first confirmation, isn't that when you go in and you, at 12 or 13, you take your first communion? Isn't that what it is as a Catholic? Well, what does that have to do with salvation? Besides that, if you take communion for the first time, it's not communion in a Catholic church. It's partaking of the Eucharist, eating the body and blood of Christ. And if you don't eat that body and blood, you can't go to heaven. They say that all Protestants are going to hell. "No one experience," he even had a rabbi on the platform to show the unity of religions. A rabbi is in a Jewish synagogue, and they don't even believe that Jesus is the Messiah. Not having a competent counselors is bad enough, but then to have led them to believe that a church experience is the same as being born again is the height of apostasy. Billy has not compromised. He has gone kaput. During the early 1991 Gulf War with Iraq, Billy Graham was summoned to the White House to pray with and for President George Bush. Graham has said that Bush is the best friend he has in the world outside of his own staff, and said that out of the war perhaps will come a new peace, and as stated by the president, a new world order. Billy Graham says there's going to come a new world order. That's the beast. World system. That's Babylon, Persia, Greece, then Rome, and it'll blossom out into the world beast system. Billy Graham says we need a world beast system. It's what he's saying. This man is crazy. And people get mad at me. Billy Graham is the sacred cow of America, the most famous preacher that's lived in the last 2,000 years. No, even all the TBN people, he is their God. Paul Crouch, Benny Hinn, they all bow to him, like, and they have his birthday special on TBN, and they all, they have all these super famous charismatics. Billy, you're God's man of this century. You're the man of the hour. You're wonderful, and we bow to you. They adore him. He lies, and they lie. Well, I just don't believe Billy Graham. Wait till the judgment. You keep siding with him, you'll go to hell with him. Do I believe Billy Graham is a believer? No, I don't believe that. He don't believe in predestination, daily cross, death, self, self-denial. He never mentions it. He thinks born again is walking down an aisle. It's not. We're born from above. That's the word again. Anothen, from above. That means the birth comes from God, not from us. It's not a walk down an aisle. God picks out who he wants to be his, and somehow he crosses your mind with the preaching of the gospel or reading a Bible, and it cuts into your heart, and you come alive, and you didn't have anything to do with it. Nothing. How can I be saved? You can't unless God births you. By his will, of his own will begat he us, we're born, not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God's will. God's birthing everybody he wills to birth. You can't get your family saved. You can't make them believers. It's already been preordained before the foundation of the world. If they're a believer, if they're elect, they'll cross the preaching of truth. It'll cut into their heart and they'll come alive. Otherwise, they won't. It's no walk down the aisle. It is no prayer. It's simply belief. And you can't believe God, but you have to, but you can't, but you have to, but you can't, but you have to, but you can't, but you have to. Then how do you believe? He has to put belief in your heart. He has to put faith is the noun, belief is the verb. If you have faith, it's the gift of God that he puts in your heart, and you will believe. I keep telling people at Grace and Truth, quit worrying about your family, your brother, your sister, your husband, your wife, your kinfolks, your mother, your father. They're either elect or they won't. Your job is, you're nothing but a water hose. That's all you are. What does a water hose have to do with the plants growing out there? It has nothing to do, but it does. It's a conduit for the water, isn't it? The water is the Holy Spirit, and it comes out of our mouth. And God says, whenever you give the truth to someone, there in the 55th chapter of Isaiah, he said, my word will not return to me void. It will accomplish whereto I send it. It'll accomplish the word that he wants it to accomplish. If we can learn that predestination is true as believers, when we try to struggle with our family, we're practicing free will. Aren't we? I'm not saying don't do everything you can. It's just like I said, if we can get air conditioners for the missionaries down in Ecuador, God just may have an air conditioner be the way that he pulls one of his elect in because it's cool in there. And they go in there just to be cool. And when they go in and sit down to be cool, they hear the truth and go, oh, I believe. Do everything that we can to preach the truth and to cause people to want to come and hear it. But we don't try to convince them to believe. Never do that. They're either elect or they're not. It's that simple. You can't change somebody's mind. I believe we believe in election and predestination. These guys who don't, I don't know how free will can be any truth in it. I can't even hang around people that believe in free will. I'm going to talk Bible and they're going to hate it. If I can help the people at Grace and Truth, you don't just sit back fatalistically and say, I saw Paul Crouch one night say, well, let's just go to church and turn on the lights. If predestination is true, let's just turn on the lights and let's just watch God do His thing. You dummy. That's not predestination. He's predestined us to conform to His likeness. He's elected us to obedience and the sprinkling of blood. But baptism was a death. So He's elected you to die to self. And you will if you belong to Him. But I'm not doing much today. Well, you will. Just wait. You'll die as much as you're supposed to die. And the more you're convicted, the more it'll bother you. I don't have to convince you. I don't worry about nothing in this ministry. I don't fight people. I just say, here's the truth. Deal with it. Well, I'll give you $1 million a week if you'll change your message. Well, I didn't start it on money. Get out of here. That's what I tell somebody. God started it and He'll finish. He'll keep it going until it's finished. I've really come to a place where I don't get greatly concerned whether people believe or not. Somebody calls me and starts arguing. A guy called me the other night and started arguing with me. He said, what about this? So I said, here's what the Bible says. Yeah, but that can't be true. And after about the second time he did that, I said, look, mister, if you want the DVDs, you can have them. Otherwise, I'm hanging up. I'm not going to sit here and argue with you. You either belong to God or you don't. You know, that's enough to stir the elect. Say, what do you mean? He didn't say that. I said, if you're elect, you belong to God. If you're not elect, you don't. You've already seen me on TV. I've given you the internet. Go on the internet, watch. And if you don't like it, then don't ever call me again, okay? Bye. You say, is that godly? Yeah, the guy's arguing with me. I'm not going to do it. He's already seen me preach a message on the internet. That's one of my messages is enough to convict all the elect of all time, isn't it? It's not whether you preach predestination. It's whether you preach any truth. It's not how much truth you preach to somebody. Give them a spoonful of truth. If they're elect, they'll say, give me some more. You can quote Genesis 1:1 and talk to them about that. And that's enough truth. It's not the Romans road of the Baptists. It's Romans 3:23 and 6:33 and 10:9 and 10. Ephesians 2:8, 9. And let's take them down to the Romans road and get them to pray this prayer. That ain't it. Give them truth of any kind. And if they're elect, they'll say, could I have some more there? Yeah, here's some more. Here's another spoonful. Well, could I have a truckload? Yeah, here you are. If we could get that in our heads as believers, does anybody have a tendency to argue with anybody? Quit. Quit that. I'm out of time. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for Your word and for truth. Help the sheep to be strong. Lord, pull us away from this doctrine of the devil that promises us everything and gives us nothing. Besides that, we're to learn to be content with such things as we have. And like Paul, we need to learn whatsoever state we're in to be content. Pushing away self. Crush us all under Your hand without being crushed. That's getting rid of self, Lord. And Lord, You're doing that with all of these fire and trials and health problems and financial problems. And it comes in different ways to different people. Teach us just to trust You. We'll glorify You and praise You for all things. We pray You'll lead us to the elect. And Lord, I really pray for the flock that You'll mature them in the Word so they can grow up and learn not to fight this thing in their minds. Just accept what comes. Say, this too is the will of God, and this too shall pass. It doesn't come to stay. We'll praise You for it all. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Bully Graham. Thank you, brother.
Appreciate it.
Do you need any checks?
Not this week.
This week, okay. I thought it's about time.
This will be the last week.
Okay, well, just let me know. I'll see you in the morning. I may be sleeping. Just tired from this weekend.